You can plug it in now.
Yes.
Yes.
And we create heat for heating up your home. So a little bit about the products we test with Robot Framework. We recently launched a new smart room controller, which has quite some radio interfaces, Wi-Fi, 868 megahertz, and even a Zigbee interface. It's accompanied with Android and iOS app. We support quite some different protocols to request heat from an appliance. So we are also, it can be used with appliances from other vendors. And the main feature is zone control. We are able to control the temperature in rooms individually and not as one whole system for your house. Besides that, we are also making the appliance control unit. It's more or less the bottom part of the appliance you see, that are the electronics that provide the HMI, control the burner, pumps, fans, valves, supply us with a bus interface to connect the thermostat to, and it also has a safety critical part because mainly we sell gas appliances, which well are under strict regulations. Then a little bit about test automation, because when I joined Bosch as a tester, I started in a project with of a previous product. We had an app and we were about to release it. The way we did that, by manually testing every use case over and over again, well, made me think we need something else about that, for that. So that's why we started looking in test automation. So first, why did we want test automation? Well, of course we want feedback. When you are developing stuff, you want quick feedback if what you develop, if that is working. The second part, we want to automate repetitive regression tests. Nothing is less boring than doing over and over the same job again. Also, we need short times to create a release because, nowadays with app development, but also for embedded products, we have the ability to update, so we can very easily create fixes or expand functionality. So that leaves us in the bottom part that we want to have agility in product development and be flexible in creating product configurations and delivering frequent updates. So how did we do that? Well, it was a long way for us. The things that are on the sheet may be well known to you, but when you start test automation, it sounds a lot easier than it actually is. So what should be done when you start with test automation? You should first decide which things you want to test on which level. Of course, you've got unit testing done by the developer themselves, integration testing, testing combined parts of your product, and in the end, the acceptance testing before you release the product. For every level, it holds that you should create a test architecture. And what you see here, the testing pyramid, when we started working on test automation, it was more or less upside down for us. So when you have unit testing, those are the most easy tests to create and to implement. When you get higher in your testing pyramid to the end-to-end testing, those tests, because you are working with a black box, are very difficult to implement. You need to manage the system from the outside. You don't have knowledge or a lot of knowledge about the inside. So those tests are way harder to implement. Therefore, the majority of testing should be done on unit testing, and only the end-to-end testing should be as less as possible. Well, when we looked at the robot framework, when we started, as I said, we had the testing pyramid upside down. And this is actually the case where robot framework can or help us. So a robot framework focuses can deliver you a lot of certain interfaces, but it requires the real product to function. Then when we look to a robot framework, history. Robot framework was first developed at Nokia. Nowadays it's maintained by the Robot Framework Foundation, and of course it's open source and you can use it for a lot of different ways. But it serves as a test automation framework, so it hands you the tools to do proper testing. Main thing is that it's very extendable with libraries, and it also provides you with good reporting functionalities. Besides a robot framework, it's distributed as a Python module. So of course you need Python, and you can extend it easily with other tooling, also Python modules. For instance, we use matplotlib, PySerial, and you can name a lot of other parts. We use Conda to as a package management system to set up our testing environment. PyCharm to write our robot test and our Python libraries, which are used by a robot framework. And of course Jenkins as a build automation tool, which kicks off the test we execute. Then a little bit about how we actually used a robot framework during our tests. First of all, I will tell a little bit about the smart room thermostat, and then my colleague Wendel will take over and tell you more about how we test our control unit. What is the room thermostat? It's good to understand a little bit how the system functions. So we have the thermostat in the middle. It can control the different rooms with electronic radiator valves. It has a bus connection to the appliance. Of course, we have the app and a backend to deliver updates and all kinds of parts. So when we want to test it, you already see some interfaces to the room thermostat. We needed to, think of a system how we can test this. So here in this picture we have the room thermostat, the different modules that are in, the main control unit, Wi-Fi module, 868 module. I left out the Zigbee for now. We have of course the connection to the appliance, we have a backend connection, and we have an app. First we decided when we decided about the testing levels, we said, okay, when we do integration testing, we only want to test the room thermostat. And we want to test the app separately. We also have a test set to test it together, but that leaves us with the following setup then. We stepped out the app, we stepped out the 868 module because that's externally supplied. We stepped out our appliance, and we connected everything to a test executor. When we put robot framework on top of that, we get test architecture, which we can see here. On top, we have our test cases, which we provide per function. Beneath that, there are resources. Robot framework supplies us with a way to define generic keywords. For instance, we have a resource to set the room temperature to 20 degrees, and we can use that in all kinds of different tests. Using resources became very handy, so you can leave out or you have a very maintainable test cases, because when you change something in your logic, you can change it inside the resources and do not have to rewrite a lot of test cases. When we go back to the bottom, we have, of course, the robot framework itself. And beneath a robot framework, we have the different libraries. These are the libraries we implemented, but a robot framework itself also comes with a lot of different libraries that are supplied by a lot of people that use a robot framework. What we did, we created a library for our H68 communication to the radiator valves, so we can actively control the way the user uses a radiator valve. We have a simulator that can say, okay, now I simulate that I press a button on the valve, and then our library provides that to the thermostat, which should give a reaction, and robot frameworks capture the reaction and checks if that is the desired function we want. By implementing this in this way, we can set up a dynamic environment. We can, sorry?
I have a question. Before we go into the implementation, can you give us a small example on what you intend to integrate in the previous video? Because right now you are describing what you intend to integrate, how you intend to implement in that figure.
What we integrate here is the behavior between the whole firmware of the main control unit. Oh, sorry. Yeah, you wanted to know what we are integrating in this figure. What we are integrating here is our firmware of the control, the main control unit, and the firmware of the Wi-Fi module. Those are both supplied by ourselves, and we want to be sure that they work fully together.
Is that end-to-end testing? Is you use it as a black box?
End-to-end testing is that we also include the app. So we change something on the app, and we want to know what happens. For instance, in the room, the user changes something with his or her app. Okay. Then back to the implementation. So. We built a library for every interface we have. So here we can create a setup. For instance, a house has four rooms with four thermostatic radiator valves, or with only one thermostatic radiator valve in a room, multiple radiator valves, and so on. So we can differentiate in how the setup is the user uses his or her thermostat. Also, we have, on the other hand, have simulated our appliance connection. So we can simulate different appliances users have. An open term appliance from a competitor, an on-off appliance, or also different appliances made by ourselves. Then in the middle, we have the API, the app users. And we also have a debug connection by which we can control the device itself, for instance, to let it reboot to certain modes and so on. On the first slide about how you should test, and the bottom it said create a testable product. Well, for instance, this debug interface is very handy for us to automate our tests, and it's really necessary to do good testing with our product. Then, at last, from my part, a little example about how we handle the different interfaces. When you send something out with robot framework, you expect an answer back. The easy way to do it is send out a comment, wait 5 seconds, and read back if there is a result. But your system behavior changes over time as you expand your product and make a more complex setup. So in that sense, testing should be a little dynamic. We in the beginning we encountered a lot of failing tests because of small changes, small timing changes and so on. When we looked better into our test, we found out robot framework has a very nice keyword that is used over here, and wait until keyword. So please, you ask robot framework, please repeat this keyword, this part. So read the line from, in this case, the serial interface, check if it's successful, and then continue. If it fails, it checks again in 1 second. So you can say it, in this part we tried 10 times with intervals of 1 second. We check if the profile has been set in this way, because we are also we have a little bit external dependencies. For instance, what is used here, the setup of a Wi-Fi connection, you cannot exactly predict the behavior you are encountering. So we use this keyword a lot in our interfaces, and our testing became much more stable than it was before. This was it for my part. My colleague Wendel will continue on the appliance control unit.
Right. Thanks everyone. I see a lot of people, so that's good news. So you care about testing, and I think that is good, because software always contains bugs. So and that's not so nice. So I will talk a little bit about the appliance itself. You can see it here. So this is a schematic overview of a home. We have a bathtub and some radiations for the heating the house. And in the bottom you see it's a combination boiler. So it provides you with warm water, and that is what I will zoom into. So if you look at this boiler, this is a more or less schematic overview of the inside of a boiler. So it's not, it doesn't have a lot of I/O. It has a fan, a pump, a valve, you see here, and then it will connect to the radiator or to the warm water supply. Also, we are very fond of acronyms, so over there you see the DHW, for example, that means domestic hot water, and so we have really a lot of acronyms, but I will try not to use them. And to control this appliance, we are developing a so-called control unit. It's a piece of electronics with software, and it controls the appliance. And what I will talk about now is how we tested the software of this control unit. So what is the software architecture inside this control unit? We have made use of a hardware abstraction layer, which means that we can run on two different platforms. On top of this hardware abstraction layer, we have the behavior of this control unit. And we have some application behavior saying when a certain request for heat comes in, we have to do this, move this pump, do this valve, that kind of things. And we have two other main parts, which is the bus communication. It's a sort of serial communication. And a burner control, which controls the flame, really the burning of the thing. And for the microcontroller on the right, that is what we will put on the control box itself. So if you go in the right flow, the end result will be a hex file, which we can flash on the microcontroller. And that we use CMake and IAR for. IAR is a compiler, proprietary. And on the left we use GCC, and the result of that is that we have a DLL. And actually both we use for testing. So the right we flash in the device, and we test it on the hardware itself. And the left we also can test. Of course on the left you have to deal with, we have some I/O and some interfacing. So you have to step that out. So why did we do this? Why would you create a PC build? Well, to my opinion, it has a lot of benefits to do this, because when you create your code as such that it works on two platforms, your code is more cleaner, so it has less pollution of header files for the certain targets. You can test actually really a lot of your functions without that the hardware is already available. You can test, for example, the communication protocol. And also you can accelerate time. So if you flash it on the real board, you really have to wait. For example, we have functions that, for example, every day we should run a pump. Okay, so we put it in the lab, we wait one day. No, it didn't work. And if you do that on the PC, we will know faster if that function is correct. So we, at the moment, we can accelerate about 26 to 50 times. So that is pretty good. So we can simulate a day in half an hour, and that saves us time. Of course, there are also disadvantages, the obvious ones. You have to do this work. So I would say, do this. Next to that, we simulated the control unit software itself on the PC platform. We also created some dynamics in Simulink, so it's a crude approximation of what the system will do in reality. We've done that with Simulink, and then also this dynamics are then there is code generated from this dynamics, and we also put it in a DLL. So we now have two DLLs. So how did we test then these two DLLs with robot framework? So we have written our test in robot framework. I will show that in a minute. And then we have written a custom robot framework library, which connects the two DLLs that I just described. And one cool thing you can see here is that we can run this test .robot. We run it through robot framework, and we can configure if it runs on the simulated environment, so to say, or on the real thing. So what we can do is run the test first on the simulated environment, which is of course close to reality but not the real thing, and then when we're satisfied we can do one last test on the actual hardware and validate if the product behaves as we want. So a little bit about the simulator setup, how this works. What we have done is that we run the physics of the physics DLL, then we copy all the values that are measured, we put it to the control unit simulator, we let the control unit do its thing, and then we copy the outputs of the control unit again to the physics, and this goes on every 10 milliseconds, it is repeated. We implemented our libraries in Python, by the way. So, now for the live demo effect. Yes, so the backup slides are there, but I don't know if they're needed. So what I want to show is...
Do we need to dock?
No, it will be okay. the function that I want to show you, what we're going to test is the what we called the chimney mode. It means chimney means the exhaust on the roof of a home. And what happens is you install a appliance in a home and you test this by hitting a button and it goes full power. And then it shuts down and then you know, okay, everything is connected correctly. So it's a sort of a test mode. So we're going to test a test mode. So as Alex already said, we used PyCharm to edit our tests. So I'll first show the test I'm going to run. Here you see the robot framework syntax. If you know robot framework, this will be familiar to you. If you don't know it, it is the intention of robot framework that these tests should read quite naturally. So how it works is that you have some keywords which indicate some steps. So what we did, we grouped our test suite into logical functions. So we have about, say, 13 function groups. And this is group 8. And then we have a test 1 of this function. And this tests the chimney mode. And what it does, it you can read what the steps are to do this test. So we set it to 100%. Then we verify that the function is activated. Then we remove this request. We check that it is gone, and also we check that it's going back to standby mode. So yeah, it's actually a pretty simple test. And what you can do with PyCharm, for example, that is really handy. You can control click and go to a keyword. And then this is a keyword which sort of implements this step. And then in this step, you see, okay, if you want to wait for standby, you have to do that by looking at a certain variable. And it has to be, the code is 203 for a standby function. We have this status code. So it will wait for the 203 for, say, 100 tenths of a second. It's quite a weird unit, but we use that. So now I will run this test. For that we use ConEmu to run our tests, and because to run a robot framework it is handy to run it from the command line. And as you see, there's now 3 tests are executed from this chimney test. And if everything is well, I hope.
Huh? Zoom out a little.
No. I don't know how to do that. So now we come also to one particular nice feature of a robot framework, which is the report. You can see the report here. It is a log of the test we just run. Of course, I don't have any hardware here, so this is the configuration for the simulated version of the previous setup. And you see that you have here all kinds of statistics, how many tests pass, fail, how much time it took. So if I zoom in on the chimney test, you will see here that in the report, zoom it a little. So in this report we have actually, you can see exactly the same steps what you have in the, as you described in the test. And green here means okay, red means not okay, but in this case it's okay. And if you look into, you can also expand this keywords, and then you see that, for example, this keyword we used, wait for EMS variable, which wait for the status for some time. You can look really into it. And also what you can do is in there, you can see what messages were passed between the test and the control unit. So that is really, as this normally when it's green, you don't look at it. When it's red, you want to know, hey, what happened? And then this comes into play. And it is really handy. And also here, you can toggle between certain levels of verbosity in the report. And one thing we did was, let's see. Go here. Yeah. So since robot framework is written with Python, we also used the matplotlib library to include some figures of the temperature, the temperatures over time. So since we started here a test mode which goes full power, you see that the temperatures went up quite a bit from 20 to 40 degrees. Of course, this is on a simulated environment, so there's no way of telling if this is precisely as it will happen in real time, but it gives you some good feeling of what goes on. And in the end, you see that the temperature stays the same because we stopped the appliance, so it will be hot for some time. And also, you can see here more at the top. This is the burner power in percentage. So how much power did we apply to the system? So first, it's a little bit. Oh. That's actually a little bit weird, but in, we also have the test mode itself, so I don't know what that first thing is, but you can see here what the system did over time. So that brings us to the summary. So what did we learn when doing this for the last, I think, year? Robot framework is a good tool to test embedded systems. You can have keywords, you have a lot of libraries, you have Python ecosystem, all these things. You have the PyCharm, IDE, and the test itself can be really readable. And also what we did was we run the test on the host system, which accelerated our testing times. What we also learned was that if you have a lot of tests, you also have to maintain these tests. So that's also what Alex said in the beginning with this pyramid. Really use a lot of unit tests and don't use a robot framework too much, I would say, because then you have to maintain all these tests. So if you have, say, 300 tests. I think in our case we have maybe 200 different test cases. That's a lot of test cases, and if something goes wrong, you have to really search where it goes wrong. So you don't, maybe you don't want to have too much of them. And also, if you have, we also developed our own libraries, and those also contain bugs sometimes. So yeah, that is something to keep into account, to keep that maybe as simple as possible. Yeah. And so that was maybe what we learned. What we want to improve, or where we want to go, we want to be able to test the room thermostat, for example, with multiple different appliance types, so that we can check if the software works with against a variety of other hardware. And in there, we want to better organize the tests. And for the control unit part, what I really would like to do is speed up these simulations even more to get the test time down, and also make this test more robust to variants of products. Since we have a lot of different, say we have a lot of control boxes, which are all small variations, and what I would like to do is that we can have one or maybe a couple of test suites, but that they run. And that they can handle this. All right, 10 minutes left. That's good, and we have time for some questions, so thank you. Yeah.
Almost an answer to that last thing you were saying about speeding up tests.
Yes.
We've got very similar stuff going on here. These are our host development things. But you can sometimes explicitly build a set of tests where you take time out entirely, so there is no virtual time at all, and then you can run them as fast as you like. It simply is how many logical steps are there to go. So rather than speeding up simulator time, write a set of tests where time is not one of the variables. That can make a huge difference.
Yeah, that's an option, but maybe that's the more a unit test what you would then write.
Well,
sorry,
that was being
the, So the question was to speed up time, you can also The question was, you can speed up time, but you can also eliminate time, right? Yeah. So, yeah, currently the system that we created is really focused on time. So that would be hard, but I would do that, what you say, in a unit test.
We've got an example here where we're moving a strangely similar piece of hardware to you, where we're simulating moving a valve, and there are a whole bunch of tests we can do which merely make sure it does the logical correct steps.
Mm-hmm.
And timing is not relevant to those. So those can just run.
You have a sequence of steps.
Like, yes.
Yeah. All right. Yeah.
Yeah. So you've covered the plethora of functional tests. What about non-functional ones? Like, do you have these ones? Is it somewhat useful for any sorts of non-functional tests?
So the question was, do you have, these are
functional
tests,
yeah.
And you mean non-functional tests.
Yeah.
Can you give an example of a non-functional test?
It could be more delayed stability-related performance. It could be kind of spamming whatever you would like to spam and what is not expected by your backend or one of your appliances.
No, we don't have the non-functional test. For example, to test the performance of the boiler, we still do that in a lab environment so that we have the real thing. We test that, so then we really know what the performance is. So it is mainly focused on the functional things.
Yep.
Cheers. Yeah.
How do you evaluate the correctness or the fullness of your test suite? I didn't see any mentions to code coverage, for example.
No. Oh yeah. So the question was how do you evaluate the completeness of the test suite? Yes. So we don't. We don't do any measures. I don't know if.
No.
So we don't use code coverage yet, but I think that is a very good idea to do that. So then we can see how much we cover. We do the code coverage. We do that when we run the unit test. We do the code coverage. But with this test, we don't have the coverage enabled.
You should more or less have requirements coverage with this, and that's very hard to track, at least in the way we were.
Yeah. Yeah.
Obviously, people don't change their central heating systems very often. So, how long do you expect to support these products? So, when you think of vulnerabilities and Internet of Things type of stuff, what I buy today,
yeah.
Do you expect to support these devices?
So the question was, how long do we support these devices?
Yes.
How long
do
we support
that? That is 7 to 8 years. 8 years, and appliance is longer.
Yeah.
There are also regulations for that.
Yeah.
How do you believe that your simulated environment is similar to the real devices?
So the question was, how do you
simulate if your simulated environment is equal to the real devices?
How do you do that? We did some measurements in the lab, and what we did with the simulated environment, we applied the same inputs and compared the outputs to what we have measured in the lab. So that's basically how we did that. Yeah? All right. Any more? In the back.
What classes of errors were you unable to model in your simulated environment, but you found in your real environment? Were there cases where the real environment found something your simulator failed to detect, and why?
So the question was, did you find in reality some extra things that you didn't find in the simulated environment? That's a good question. So in our simulated environment, for example, our temperatures are really smooth. We don't have any noise. So in our reality, there's always noise. So, yeah. So this is something that we found in our labs. That, for example, we had some noise on a sensor, and that we didn't spot in the simulated environment because everything was maybe too ideal.
It's actually a real case that I need to fix is exactly that I have something tripped up by noise.
So we can shake hands.
Okay. Have you tried to simulate the noise in the test environment?
We thought about that. So the question was, have you tried to simulate the noise in the test environment? I'm a little bit opinionated about that because I don't like randomness in the test. So if you would do that, then you would add some random variation to the test. And then you have the situation where you run the test once, it fails. You run it again, it works. What? I don't like that, but you could do that. So I think we should do something like that.
Sorry, solution to that one, I hear what you say, is that we run our test first once, then 10 times, then 1,000 times, and it's cheap to run the test thousands of times. So you can get round, I agree what you say, but it's definitely going to work if it gets through the 10,000 run test, and then you can go with the randomness.
Yeah. So I think what we want to do is some kind of, what we also want, what I would like to do is some kind of fuzzing the system. So put in somewhat of random inputs to check if that will disturb it. Yeah.
I actually have two questions. What's the role of the backend, and did you test the backend as well?
So that's more a question for Alex.
The question was, what is the role of the backend, and do we test that as well? Well, that's a little bit an organizational answer we have there, because what I showed is the part of the product we create. The backend is maintained in a different team. It's also used for different products, so they also have their own tests. But what we do continuously in our integration tests is we use the backend in the test. So when things go wrong, it also could be in the backend. So that is not ideal in the repeating the test cases and seeing what goes wrong. But just to be sure we don't miss anything, we use it actively in our testing. Yes, we also test. Your question was if we also test the API, and yes, we do, because that's a way robot framework interfaces with our thermostat, also by using the API and setting comments like the aptos. Yes. Your question was, if I understand correctly, how do we manage the different platforms we run the test on, the simulated platform, the on-target testing? Those are defined, which we can give to robot framework on startup. So we have a configuration file which configures the environment you want to test. But the actual switch between the platforms is in our Python library. So a robot frame, we did not implement any switch actively in robot framework, but we implemented it in the Python code.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much to our presenters. Yeah. Please, a big hand.
Thank you very much for listening.
This session is complete. Thank you very much. Thank you.